Okay, well, thank you all very much for coming to this debt and deficit panel. We know it's a scintillating subject. We're going to do our best to make it interesting. And we also know that we're competing against the second richest man in the world, so thank you all for coming here rather than to find out from him how to be the second richest man in the world. I'm going to, you know, budgets are all about, or a lot of it about baselines and knowing where you start from. And so I'm not going to do any introductions. Hopefully you know who everybody is here, and if you don't, take out your smartphones and Google them. But I'm going to do three quick slides to kind of set a baseline for discussion so that as my colleagues here get into the depths of this, hopefully everyone will know what they're talking about and know where we're coming from. So the first slide, which we can put up, which is slide number one, gives you a sense of how those of us in the budget business measure deficits and debt and progress or lack of progress. And one of the measures we use is the ratio of the debt to the gross domestic product. In other words, how much debt as a percentage of GDP, and we look at debt held by the public as opposed to total debt. And this slide compares four plans, and there's a lot of other plans. I know Senator Corker has a plan. Simpson and Bowles recently came out with a new version of their plan, but these are four kind of representative plans. The first line at the top, the black dotted line, which actually these are Maya's numbers, so if anybody doesn't like them, they should speak to Maya, not me, after this panel. But this first line is the current policy. It does not include sequestration, the forced budget cuts that are in place now, which would actually lower it a little bit. But as you can see, it takes the debt to deficit from currently about 73%, up a bit, close to 80%, comes down a little bit, then it goes back up to essentially 80%. And that's essentially the trajectory we are on. And then you have the next plan down, the dotted blue line, is President Obama's recent plan. And you can see, as many of you probably have read, that he proposed to spend some more money in the short run, then cut the deficit in the long run, and essentially bring that ratio right back to where it is today. Senator Patty Murray, the chairwoman of the Senate Budget Committee, has a plan. And I'll get into just a little bit of detail on these plans in a second. And she would cut the GDP to debt ratio, by just a little bit to 70%. And then finally, Congressman Ryan has a plan which is the most dramatic, as you can see here. It would actually balance the budget over the next 10 years and bring that debt ratio down to 55%. So if we can go to slide two, you'll see a very high level comparison of the three plans. Starting from the left, President Obama has proposed $1.8 trillion. Now remember, there's been a lot of deficit reduction already. I'm sure we'll get into that on this panel, about $2.5 trillion worth, and so these are all amounts over the next 10 years on top of that $2.5 trillion that's occurred. So President Obama has $1.8 trillion, a bit more in new revenues, taxes than in spending cuts. Senator Murray's is evenly balanced, and Congressman Ryan's is essentially all from the spending side. And if we go to the third slide, you'll see a little bit of detail on how those spending reductions would occur. First category is discretionary spending, which is essentially defense and other things that are not mandated, like entitlements and other kinds of unemployment insurance, things that are essentially on autopilot at the moment. And so Congressman Ryan has the most significant cuts, followed by Senator Murray, and then the president's cuts are far more modest. And you may remember that the sequestration is around $1 trillion of spending cuts, and so both the president and Patty Murray would roll a lot of those back. The president then proposes to spend $240 billion over the next 10 years, as I showed you before, essentially in the short run to try to get the economy going and some money for infrastructure and things like that. Patty Murray has a smaller amount, and the Ryan plan doesn't have any. On Social Security, you may hear us talk about the chained COLA, the chain cost of living adjustment. That's what's in President Obama's proposal, got a lot of attention. Neither Senator Murray nor Paul Ryan have addressed that at this moment. Paul Ryan proposes to repeal the Affordable Care Act, and that would save $1.8 trillion, assuming that you find those revenues, you keep those revenues or replace them with some other kind of revenues. And Senator Murray and President Obama don't want to change it. And then under Medicare and Medicaid, neither the president nor Congressman Ryan would do much to Medicare in the next 10 years. They have other proposals for after that. But so most of these reductions that you see here are from the Medicaid program. And then finally, other mandatory is, as I said, is things like unemployment insurance, food stamps, a whole bunch of federal pensions, a whole bunch of things that are essentially on autopilot subject to changing the law. Paul Ryan has some major reductions in those. The other two don't. And with that, let me turn to the panel and start by asking, why don't I start with Senator Corker on my right. the deficit has come down quite a bit, partly because of some of the things that I just talked about, partly because of the economy may be a little bit better. And so I think this year we're looking at a deficit of under $800 billion compared to $1.1 trillion last year. And meanwhile, the economy is still very weak and some would argue actually getting weaker at the moment. So how much deficit reduction do we really need? Should we really be putting in place at this point in time?
A lot. You know, the problem with all these models is that we haven't yet dealt with the issue that has to be dealt with, which is entitlement reform. And when you deal with entitlement reform, it doesn't really have an effect today or tomorrow or the next day on the economy. It's something that you do over time. So, you know, Steve, the problem is, yes, we've reduced spending, and yes, deficits have come down, but you've also seen in the out years it spikes through the roof over time because we haven't yet dealt with entitlements. With sequester and with the other kinds of cuts that we've had through the Budget Control Act, you have to fight to keep those in place each month. When you do entitlement reforms, they are here forever, and that's where the money is. And so the problem with all of these budgets is none of them, not a single one of them. And I give the president credit, by the way, for having changed CPI. The House budget has zero changes to Medicare or Social Security over the next 10 years. So, you know, that's where we need to focus. You say that our debt is at 70 or 80%. We're actually at 104% debt to GDP if you calculate it like other nations, where you actually add in all the things that we owe each other through the budget. So again, the problem is that we have not dealt with the entitlements. I think the sweet spot for us is Republicans are asking for 75-year actuarial soundness on Medicare and Social Security. And in return for that, Republicans are willing to look at revenues through tax reform. That's where the entire focus of our discussions needs to be. That's where I hope it's going to be over the next 3 or 4 months.
So relative to the numbers that we looked at a couple slides ago, what would be your number for deficit reduction over the next 10 years, from the anywhere from the president's $1.5 trillion all the way up to Congressman Ryan's $6 trillion?
You know, I think it depends on what you count. I'll give you a good example, Steve. This week, Dennis McDonough was in talking to 20 Republican senators, and one fairly intelligent Republican senator, very intelligent, I might add, walked out and says, you know, here's the deal. The president is wanting us to give up $1 trillion in the sequester and trade it for another trillion in cuts. He wants to replace it. And for the privilege of that, he wants us to have another $600 billion in revenues. Now, in fairness, the trade is one that's more qualitative. So I would get back to you and say, Steve, it depends on the qualitative measure of what we're doing. If it's with entitlement reforms, which will save us tens and 20s and 30s trillion dollars down the road, it would be one number. If it's over the short term, other kinds of things, which is very hard to keep in place, it would be another. But I do think we need to get our overall, including the entitlements, right now, again, we're at 104% of debt to GDP. I think we need to get it down into the 65% level for our country to be healthy, and I think we can do that over time without hurting the economy today if we do it through those entitlement programs and with some revenues.
Well, if you do the numbers the way I did it, that would actually take the debt to GDP number down into the 30s or 40s, I think, on that other basis, which is even more significant than Congressman Ryan's proposal.
Yeah, but 65%.
65%. Yeah. Peter, you've talked a lot about healthcare and the fact that healthcare inflation is either moderating or maybe even going down. Healthcare expenditures may be going down. And of course, that's where the money is. And if we get 1% less of healthcare inflation over the next 10 years, problem solved.
Yeah, let's actually, right? Just to illustrate that, if we could pull up first chart 6, which shows you that the long-term fiscal path is really being driven by that red line. It's not too hard to figure out that's the one going up. And that's the core long-term fiscal problem, as Senator Corker mentioned. Now, if we could also, though, pull up chart 9, what that shows you is if, and it's unfortunate the red line has become the blue line, but if the blue line is that basically the same graph that you saw on chart 6, but the red line on this chart is very interesting because what this shows you is if in the future we continue to grow at the same rate in Medicare cost per beneficiary as we have over the past 5 years, there's no increase in Medicare as a share of GDP, period. The entire long-term deficit in Medicare disappears. So we should be putting all of our emphasis on trying to accomplish that feat.
All right.
But if you believe these lines, you don't have to do anything.
Well, the question is, how likely is it that that will actually occur? And I'd say, look, the deceleration, I'm increasingly convinced, is at least partially structural. It's probably not entirely structural. The economy's played a significant role. So the question is, what can we do to make the red line there more likely? That is a much more productive discussion to be having than doing things like the sequester, which is too soon, too much too soon, and it doesn't do anything, as Senator Corker mentioned. It doesn't really do anything for the long term. So the question is, basically our entire fiscal discussion should really collapse to this chart. What can we do to move from the blue line to the red line? We've got a little bit of good history going, but what else could we do? And I mentioned to Steve earlier, there's a brand new proposal out today from the Engelberg Center at Brookings. There was an earlier proposal about a week ago from the Bipartisan Policy Center with serious bipartisan proposals for Medicare reform. I was part of the Engelberg group, so I can tell you very briefly about that. What it would do is Republicans basically want to move Medicare to a fixed payment per beneficiary so that you've got some certainty over the path of future Medicare spending.
Some Republicans.
What this proposal does is it embraces that concept, but instead of the fixed payment going to insurance companies, the fixed payment would instead go to providers, hospitals or doctor groups. And that's actually very similar to the proposal that's already embodied in the health legislation, the Accountable Care Organizations, but it does it much more expansively. It basically says within the next 10 years, the vast majority of Medicare payments should be of this kind of capitated type of form. And it's got bipartisan support. Tom Daschle and Mike Leavitt are both on it, along with a whole variety of other leaders. That's the kind of proposal that we really should be paying a lot of careful attention to, because it would make the red line here much more likely.
Dave, you're a businessman who's gotten yourself very deep into the Washington world on the Simpson Bowles Commission and one of the steering committee members who fixed the debt and so forth. When you watch all this go on in Washington, as a businessman, what do you think should happen?
Well, obviously, as you might imagine, as a businessman, it looks a lot simpler to me than it seems to be. And I've been struck by a couple of things, and Senator Corker's probably heard me say these before, but one, all conversation here seems to be driven by what I refer to as the three H's: histrionics, hysteria, and hyperbole. And there seems to be very little discussion of facts, and when people start to focus on the facts, they look at things differently. And in terms of how the negotiation goes on, the other observation I've had is, growing up in New Hampshire running companies, what I thought, what I said, what I did all had to be the same thing. But if you're in Washington, that's three separate decisions. What you think isn't necessarily what you say. What you say isn't necessarily what you do. What you do isn't even necessarily what you think.
Except Bob Corker, right?
I think he'd actually agree with me.
I
don't think so.
Yeah, I think I love it when I have to tell you, I find that very offensive. Mm. And I love it. I've spent a lifetime in business. I've been there 6 years. Mm. And I think in every case, I try to make all of those line up. And I think sometimes business people who live in a sort of a two-dimensional world don't take into account some of the fact that you're representing a country and you have a lot of different things to deal with. So I'm actually surprised that as much as you've worked mm-hmm. with people who are trying to solve this problem, I think you view me as one of those. But to make that kind of comment, to degrade many good people who serve in the public arena and are facing tremendous pressures as we try to deal with these issues, I'm surprised you would say that after the time you've spent in Washington and Steve trying to solve this problem.
Well, there goes my attempt to be humorous in the yeah. crowd. And if I offended, that certainly wasn't the intent. And where I was going to go next was to say the context that I try to put this whole debt problem in is that we need an American competitiveness agenda. And Honeywell's about a $40 billion company, 130,000 employees, more than half of the sales and revenue and people outside the US. And our world has changed a lot in the last 20 years, and we're still acting like we did 20 years ago. debt is just one piece of it that we need to address. It's debt, energy, infrastructure, math and science education, a free trade, tort reform, which sounds like a standard corporate refrain, but that we need to address all of these. And this is a fundamental part of it. When it comes to the growth rate in healthcare spending, one of the things that would concern me is I hope we can move that blue line down to the orange. Completely agree, that's where we ought to try. But I sure wouldn't predicate our entitlements programs based upon that happening. Rather, I think we'd be better off assuming that we just got a kind of a nice pickup here, but that I wouldn't do it that way going forward. And I'd try to find some way to adjust those programs today. And in the event that it happens the way we hope we could, where we get the blue line down to the orange, then we can always change it back. But I sure wouldn't predicate a plan that way.
So Maya, I don't want to get you between Bob Corker and Dave Cote on Washington, but I don't know that any of us would view that what's happened so far as optimal. There's been a fair amount of deficit reduction, but it's been haphazard. It's not been thoughtful. It's not been necessarily focused on the right issues. Why do you think Washington can't address what I guess all of us sitting up here seems like an obvious problem?
Right. Well, I mean, there is some good news, and that's true, right? We've had some savings. So through kind of a bunch of smaller pieces, we've saved about $2.5 trillion. Meanwhile, since people started talking about trying to save $4 trillion, time has marched on, and though it used to be the need to save $4 trillion to get you to that same place would now be $6.5 trillion. So we're losing time. And I think more sort of importantly, we're seeing that even though each one of the budgets that came out, and it was good that there was a budget out of the Senate, we hadn't had that until recently, so we had a House budget, a Senate budget, the President's budget, each one of them did emphasize fiscal responsibility, and they all put the debt on a downward path. I think that the President would have to do more. I think when you have the estimates, you'll see that it's not on a downward path for long enough, but there's an emphasis on fiscal responsibility. I also think there may be deficit fatigue, which is somebody who loves talking about the budget can barely imagine that, but I think people are kind of sick of the issue. And I think there's now a discussion about how much we have to do and if we really need to make changes. And the truth is, and this is the part that worries me the most, one, I think it would have been easier to do a big comprehensive debt deal all at once. You just put all of it on the table. Everybody kind of hates the different pieces, but you surprise on the upside.
But it obviously wasn't easier because it didn't happen.
Well, I guess that reflects it. They couldn't get that done. That's true. So we're going in incremental pieces. And what's left now
and
is the hardest
bit. Sorry to interrupt you, but just to go back to something you said a minute ago, but the incremental pieces, nobody's gone line by line and say, what about this program, what about that program? It's all been, let's have freezes, let's have sequestration.
Precisely. So what we've done is the easy parts. We did spending caps.
That's easy, but it's not great.
Spending caps, which are... No, but I'm saying we've had some savings. We've moved in the direction of getting some savings, not nearly enough. But those savings are the easy parts because caps, you don't have to identify where the savings is going to come from. And the tax rates on the well-off was kind of a politically easy piece. But what we didn't do were the two core pieces, reforming the entitlements, the healthcare system and the retirement system, and overhauling the tax code in a way that could generate revenue while making the U.S. more competitive. I mean, just keep in mind, we lose over $1 trillion a year in tax expenditures, deductions, exclusions. There is so much reform that we could do there, which could be a twofer, where we could raise revenues, bring rates down, make us more competitive. But, and this was your original question, the political system is in a really tough spot. It is very difficult to get bipartisan cooperation. One of the things I'm worried about right now is that you see the Senate kind of starting to work on can we get a big framework in place, and the House is focused on tax reform and how you're going to get, I mean, Republicans and Democrats aren't the only two differences. The way the Senate works and the House are very different right now, and how you bring the body together on such a hard issue, even when I think there's kind of a shared understanding of we don't need to do that much deficit reduction now. We can put these changes, phase them in slowly. The real objective is to get the debt at a certain level at the end of a decade. We can sort of agree on that kind of a framework, but there's so many tough political choices, and it's a very partisan and divided environment.
Peter wants to say something, and I want to go to taxes in a minute, but before I do, Peter, and I'll give you a chance.
I want to comment on the discretionary spending part. Because,
that's what I want to ask you about.
And actually, we have a slide 10 on this. I think it's not the easy part. I think this is the completely misleading part, just to be honest. It's been a sort of meretricious form of deficit reduction.
It's easy politically.
It's easy politically only because it's not real.
Yeah.
I doubt very much we're actually going to fully abide by the path that we're on. And by the way, if we did, it would be, I think, highly undesirable. So this chart shows you non-defense discretionary spending. That is the part of the budget that's set each year by the Congress. outside of the defense budget. The blue line is the average since 1970. The red line is the lowest level as a share of GDP since 1970. And then the purple, orange, and green lines are the various paths that we're on. And I'll leave it up to you to decide whether even either the purple or the orange line looks particularly realistic. So, for example, by 2023, we are well below the lowest level we've been ever been at since 1970. And just to give you some sense of the numbers, if instead of winding up at like 2.5, you wound up at 3.25, or let's do 3.5 because the math is easy, that's an extra $2 trillion on the 10-year deficit. So all of that ostensible deficit reduction falls away. And you're back to whether that's actually likely to happen. It's really easy to say in 2023, we promise non-defense discretionary spending will not exceed this level without identifying the individual programs that you're going to cut or how you're going to add up to that number. And I fear we're doing this in exactly the wrong way. So this is basically the deficit reduction we're doing. And if you're going to do delayed fiscal austerity, in other words, phase in deficit reduction over time, you want it to be specific, you want it to be gradual, and you want it to be hard to reverse, which entitlement reform you can do. In this, it violates all three of those principles. It's not specific. I guess you could say it's kind of gradual. But it's the easiest thing to reverse because the Congress has to vote on this form of the budget anyway, each year.
Yeah. Bob, you, I think, have spoken pretty positively about sequestration. I think you said it was a vote you were happy to take in favor of it. So would you like to speak about what Peter just said?
So, back in when the Budget Control Act was passed in August of 2011, you know, we were raising the debt ceiling. The country, unfortunately, was worried about a calamity. And, you know, the question was $2.1 trillion in deficit reduction enough? And so the vote, I mean, a lot of Republicans voted against the Budget Control Act because they didn't think it was enough. At the end of the day, if you can get any kind of reduction, and if you remember, a part of this was to have a super committee of six Republicans and six Democrats who would come up with a second portion of that, which, by the way, Steve, hopefully was going to be entitlement reform. I mean, who could have imagined that six Republicans and six Democrats couldn't come up with $1.2 trillion in cuts over the next decade when we're going to spend $47 trillion of your money. So, yes, I'm glad I made the vote because what's happened is the sequester has kicked in. I think it's incredibly ham-handed. I think it's going to do damage to our country over time. But what I think it's done, Steve, is created an environment where hopefully over the next 3 or 4 months, we'll deal with the issues that actually matter. And you have more and more groups that are coming up, like Peters and others, that are making the kind of suggestions that need to take place on entitlement reform. So again, and tax reform. So again, those are the only two things that matter. I agree with Peter. Look, on the floor, my same friends in the Senate that care so much about deficit reduction, we'll have a popular bill that will come up, a highway bill, or any other bill, and they'll violate the Budget Control Act just like that. So it is illusory. It's almost fake because keeping us those levels is going to be very difficult. We have to fight for it every month. And so the best way to deal with this issue is to go ahead and do those entitlement things, do the tax reform piece. There is a reaching out that's taking place right now by the White House that is, by the way, being very well received. And I'm hopeful, unless Maya's concern is correct, and I will tell you, the one thing that bothers me right now, there's an atmosphere that's right to solve this problem. I don't feel the urgency on the matter that I felt 6 months ago. I am worried that people are bored with the topic and moving on. And somehow or another, we've got to refocus and get this done between September 15th.
So I want to come in a minute to what might actually happen, but let me just finish on what should happen. Peter, listening to you talk about this entitlements proposal that's coming, and Bob, having read about your proposal, and you referred to it in your opening remarks, for a premium support program, but without a cap, and I think,
that's right.
So I'm not really clear where you guys disagree in terms of how we should solve
the only
Medicare
disagreement
problem.
There is where the payment goes. Under premium support, the individual receives the payment, goes to the insurance company. Under the proposal that I've embraced, the payment goes to the hospital or to the provider.
And why is that better?
Because I think it more directly aligns the incentives. What you really need to get at now, premium support, you're sort of banking, it's a bank shot. You're hoping that the insurance companies will then exert pressure on the hospitals and the doctors to change their incentives and make it work better. Or at least that's the sort of one of the key assumptions. I'd rather just do it directly. And by the way, just politically, The Democrats have already embraced that basic concept under bundled payments and accountable care organizations, all the other pieces of the Affordable Care Act. So why not just kind of dial it up faster?
So what's wrong with that?
So I'd be very open at looking at that. And again, when you refer to premium support, Steve, there's another thing that's occurred. You know, it began where you mentioned the Ryan budget a couple of years ago, where it was just a fixed amount. There's an evolution in that, and basically the concept I've laid out is one that Alice Rivlin and Domenici have laid out, where you don't cap the premium support. But the premium support drives people to plans like what is being laid out here. In other words, we got a $290 million score from CBO just by laying out a competitive process, which again doesn't cap the amount. And so it's those types of things where we need to move. We need to move Medicare to a program that is more like what Peter has laid out and hopefully what I have laid out.
And what you're both saying, just to be clear, is you want to introduce competition into the healthcare system and not have it all rest on Medicare. And so, Dave, again, as a businessman, does that make sense to you?
Well, I'm all in favor of competition generally. One of my concerns, I guess, is that whatever it is that we do, it really has to drive down the overall amount that we're spending. And this whole idea of stuff being illusory is a concern, because it's whatever we do, it has to be a market-credible plan. It has to be the sort of thing that if you're in the bond or stock market, you look at it and say, our government has gotten serious. I know I've got to take a bubble for a bit because of the boomer generation and the recession, but over time it comes down. And that I can count in the second and third decade that happens. If that argument can be made in a way that's market credible, I think you get a very different reaction in markets. And if you take a look at how do we plan Honeywell today, I look at the US as a 2% GDP economy, Europe zero, Japan not continuing to do much. And the reason for that is no government's really dealing with their debt. This is our problem. If we can do a market credible plan that addresses that issue, I think we get a very different economy than what we're dealing with today.
So let's turn to revenues for a second. And before we get into tax expenditures and rates and all that stuff, Maya, you've got the president at $1 trillion. You've got Paul Ryan at zero. How much revenue do we need to make these numbers work on a 10-year basis?
Well, I think the frustrating thing is that the amount of revenues that we picked in the fiscal cliff deal, $600 billion, was absolutely the worst number we could have arrived at, because it was a point where Democrats have said, clearly we're going to need more revenue. When the negotiations started, Boehner put 800 out there, the president put twice that much, we knew it was going to be higher than 600. And yet 600 has been enough that Republicans have said, okay, we've paid up, we're done, no more revenues. And the fact that we're back at this fight about whether there's going to be revenues or not is a waste of time, because you can't finish the deal without there being more revenues. You're going to have to look at all parts of the budget. As we just talked about, we've been focusing on discretionary, which is not the right part of the focus. There's going to need to be real structural entitlement reform, and there are going to have to be more revenues. My guess is right now that the number that's on the table is $600 billion. I'm sort of tired of watching all this get negotiated smaller. I wish we were negotiating up, and we were going to do more in revenues and more in entitlement reform.
More than $600 billion of revenue?
If we were going to do real
from
entitlement
where we are today.
Reform, yeah. Because I think the kind of deals that we're talking about aren't as big as they need to be. When we started thinking about this, we were thinking about how you get the debt, which has historically been below 40% of GDP, at least to 60% of GDP by the end of the decade. We've all kind of loosened our aspirations, and now you said 65, but mostly people are talking about 70% of GDP. I would rather have an overall bigger deal that was credible, that was backloaded, and that really in the second decade did a lot to change. But I'd rather have something than nothing. And so my guess is that they're going to negotiate this down a little bit, that it's going to be a little bit less than $600 billion in revenues.
Of new revenue on top of what we have so far.
But the key here, the fight we had around the fiscal cliff deal about how to get those revenues, which focused on rates, was absolutely wrong. It's going to have to come from overhauling the tax code and through tax reform. And it's only through doing it through tax reform that can be pro-growth and pairing it with entitlement cuts that I think you can get a political bargain that's workable.
Peter, a couple of years ago, you thought that the numbers didn't work unless you repealed all the Bush tax cuts. You still feel that way, or is another 600?
Yeah, no, I do. But let's be clear. There are two things on the revenue side. One is, precisely because we should be doing entitlement changes and because those phase in gradually, you're not going to get that much traction, as Senator Corker said, over the next decade from what you do in entitlements. And so that raises a question, which is, if you're worried about the situation in like 2020 to 2030 before the entitlement stuff really starts to kick in, what will plug the hole when these turn out to be illusory, when the non-defense discretionary spending reductions don't turn out to actually be implemented? And my view is the fact that that's implausible is the flip side of saying the revenue base in like 2023 is inadequate. And so yes, I would favor, and I know it's not politically popular, but I would have favored gradually phasing out all the tax cuts rather than just the upper income ones. That's one one question. But the second question, which is what Maya was raising, is we know that the tax code is not, no one would claim it's optimal or, you know, ideal. And so the question is, how can you make it more efficient? And the one idea where I think you could start to see some agreement is all the various things that the tax code subsidizes, home ownership, healthcare, retirement savings, there are all these things that are sort of seen as socially desirable activities that the tax code provides a subsidy for. But it provides a subsidy in the in a form in which someone in the highest marginal tax bracket gets a much higher per dollar subsidy than someone who's a middle class family in the 15% marginal bracket. That makes no sense from a fairness perspective, but more importantly, it makes no sense from an economic efficiency perspective, because unless you think high income households have a stronger response to the per dollar subsidy, you wouldn't tilt the subsidies in that way. It opens up the idea, which Republicans have, or at least some Republicans have embraced, and there's parts of the administration's budget which also kind of moves in this direction, of taking all of those tax expenditures and moving them to a flat rate credit, so for mortgage interest, for retirement saving, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, you do a dollar of that activity and everyone gets the same tax credit, 15% or 20% or whatever, that could both raise revenue and make the tax code more progressive.
Well, Bob has a proposal to limit deductions to $50,000, I think, right? Isn't that your tax plan?
Yeah, so at the end of the year, you know, to show that it's really not difficult to do all of these things legislatively, I wrote a bill that went through every detail of Medicare, Social Security, Medicaid, and on the tax reform piece, Steve, and by the way, it was only like 230 pages long. It's not that difficult to do these things if you just, and I know you were just being funny on the front end, if you just have the courage to make those decisions, it's easy to implement, okay? Very easy to implement. On the tax code piece, I was just trying to show at that time there is a way to generate revenues without looking at rates. And it actually generated more, by the way, than came in at the end of the fiscal year. I do think getting back to that.
But you're in favor of it. You said
I'm in favor of tax reform, absolutely.
No, but are you in favor of limiting deductions to $50,000?
Absolutely. We give away $1.2 trillion a year in the tax code. And all of those have built up over time on top of each other. Many of them are not even productive anymore. But absolutely, I'm in favor of tax reform.
And would you, for example, some people want to exempt charitable from that limit? Charitable deductions?
So I think what people have done, so that you don't get into that fight, I mean, every university, every Christian and Jewish group in America, everybody aligning against, what some people have said is, hey, look, why don't you just give an overall amount? And you can, it's a little different than what Peter just said, but you know, you can take a home mortgage deduction if you wish. You can give money to charity if you wish. But the maximum cap you're going to get is X. That's another way of looking at it. There are, by the way, multiple ways of getting through, getting rid of all the loopholes, but that's one way of doing
it. I'll let you talk, but it would, I'll ask you the question, but it would significantly affect charitable giving and home ownership and all the things that are, in fact, as Peter said, being subsidized, right? We can't kid ourselves that if you actually limited deductions like this, it would have a significant effect.
Right, but the kinds of caps that are being talked about here, the fact that you don't get rid of some of the tax breaks at all makes it, one, politically easier, but two, you still have some of those incentives. So if you capped all of your tax breaks, and you could take some of them out, but I don't think you would need to in this case, you're still getting a deduction for a charitable unless you've hit your limit, at which point you've already done some limit, you've done home mortgage, you've done charitable, you've gotten enough tax breaks. But the thing about these tax caps that I think is very helpful, in addition to making it politically easier, is you can craft them in different ways. You can say, we're not gonna count the earned income tax credit if you don't want to. You can decide whether you're gonna include capital gains and dividends or not. You could even have two different amounts, so it's more progressive. It's an elegant way to help do tax reform, that doesn't mean every single K Street lobbyist is going to be lined up trying to protect their individual tax break, because you just put them in one bundle and cap them either as a share of your income or as a dollar amount. And I think it's going to be much easier to get tax reform done if we take that approach.
But let me just say what's going to happen.
Can you hold 1 minute up before on what's going to happen? Let's talk about what should happen, and then we're going to come to what's
going
to happen.
Well, I'm back on the tax reform side, because there's this fiscal principle that says over time, every organized system evolves towards chaos, entropy. And I think that's what's happened with our tax system. If you take a look at the last time we tried doing this, 25, 30 years ago, if you take a look at the differences between individual cap gains and corporate taxes, big variability. C corporation tax returns are down by about a third on a percent of total versus what they were 20 years ago because of how people organize. We have the $1.2 trillion in tax expenditures the senator was talking about. All of those tend to be market distortions. If you're getting one of those market distortions, you are very much in favor of it continuing. And at some point, we ought to just start with, in this new, different world that we're in, where we now have 4 billion participants in the global economy instead of the billion that we had 20 years ago, we need to do something different to have a truly competitive country in what's a different world. And I think we ought to be taking a shot at saying, how do we super simplify? How do we make the top rate the same for individual corporations and capital gains, and eliminate a lot of the junk that's in the system today? We ought to at least try.
So let's turn to what is going to happen, and let me just play the cynic for a second and actually pick up on something I think you said, Bob, which is it doesn't feel like much is happening at the moment. It feels like Washington is on to other things, guns, immigration, whatever. And maybe there'll be a Donnybrook over the debt ceiling this summer when that comes up, if some people want to hold that up as a way to force action. But otherwise, it doesn't feel like a lot is happening. So what is this group, appear before this group 6 months from now, what will have happened?
Well, the backstop, of course, will be the debt ceiling when it comes up. And that is projected right now. Most people are thinking around September 15th. Revenues have come in more strongly than people anticipated in April. So that's going to be the backstop. And what I hope is going to happen, Steve, is that, you know, instead of waiting until a crisis is fabricated, and at that point could be real, I hope we're going to work at it in advance, again, and have something done in advance. But again, and there are efforts underway, okay? There are efforts underway right now, a lot of efforts with tax reform that are underway between Camp and Baucus. But again, there's something in the public even. It's almost like the public is tired of this issue, and I'm hoping that we can very much redirect now. There's a lot of activity at the White House, a lot of activity between the White House and individual senators. And again, I hope at least by July 1st, we will be on to serious negotiations about what will happen. I think the only way we end up with a deal is for the White House to negotiate directly with a group of Republican senators. I think that's the only way we're going to get to a place that actually solves this. I don't think we can do it with another gang like we did with immigration reform, because again, the White House is so important in causing this to be appropriately socialized among Democrats and getting the House in a place to actually support this. So on tax reform, though, let me just go back. I don't think there will be limitations on charitable giving by the time it's all said and done. I know the president has laid out, you know, deductions at 28% for the upper income. My guess is charitable deductions will not be capped, and my guess is that you'll still end up with a home mortgage deduction, which could be capped, especially for upper income.
That obviously reduces the revenue potential reasonably significantly. Peter, you're a veteran of budget wars, both Capitol Hill and the White House. Are you as optimistic as Bob?
It depends on the time period. So, the thought that we're going to have a mega deal, you know, around the debt limit is, yeah, exactly.
It won't be many, but it won't be mega. Yeah. I think it's going to be.
It going to be $1.5 trillion?
Yeah, and just to illustrate the difficulties, just let's step back for a second, even on the non-charitable stuff, because I do think even a $50,000 cap on the total, you're going to get so much pushback from the organizations that receive charitable contributions in large amounts that are over $50,000, which is a very large share of total charitable giving, that you're going to get significant. But even apart from that, I mean, we need to step back and realize how easy is it going to be to cut back on the tax preference for state and local bonds when state and local governments are just coming out of a severe economic downturn themselves? How easy is it going to be to cut back on the home mortgage interest deduction, even at the top end, when most of the evidence suggests that when you do that, it gets very quickly capitalized into home prices, just when the housing industry thinks it's getting back on its feet? If you go down the list of where the major items are coming out of the period that we've just been in, you can immediately see how challenging this is going to be. It's very desirable. We should do it. But the political difficulty, which is always hard, I think is accentuated given what we have just lived through.
I'm the moderator. I'm not supposed to have opinions, but I do think there's some merit in what you're saying. But I hope Bob is right. I'll leave it at that. I think we should go to questions in a second. I'm not sure how that works, but if people have questions, why don't you raise your hands and I will call on you. Dave or Maya, is there anything you want to add while people are formulating their questions on what you think is going to happen?
Well, I think we have to learn lessons about why it didn't happen around the fiscal cliff, because that was the best moment to try to get a deal. And we do have these action-forcing moments. The sequester is kind of a slow burn. The debt ceiling is a very extreme thing to negotiate around. It's going to be in play. But hopefully we'll have gotten far enough before the debt ceiling hits that it's just kind of the last piece that helps pull a deal together. And then there's still that, there'll be, at the end of the fiscal year, we'll have to deal with continuing resolutions or how we're going to fund the government. So there are many action-forcing moments. But I think you started this off in the right way, which is the appetite for this is gone a little bit. And I think it's because it's hard, and I think it's because there's plenty of opposition for all the things that we need to do. And I think it's important that we have to spell out sort of how there cannot be a real economic recovery, how the U.S. cannot be fully competitive unless we put in place the deal that shifts how we spend money and how we raise money and add some stability that we don't currently have, and that there's some terrible consequences, the downside of inaction, which you won't know until it happens. It will be too late to pull back if we wait till the last minute. So I think part of this is how you get that back into the discussion, and I think the bottom line, and we're seeing some of this, is it will require presidential leadership. I think that President Obama is going to have to stay very engaged in this topic in order for us to see it to continue to move forward in the summer.
Steve, can I make one really quick point on why the impetus? We also have to just be honest here. Part of the reason the impetus is diminished, or the sort of incentive is diminished, is we went ahead and did this non-defense discretionary reduction. So it looks on paper like we did a whole bunch of stuff. And I agree with Senator Corker that over time, as people see that doesn't really work so well, it will create an incentive for the right kind of deal. But we do have to realize by reaching the wrong kind of deal, it sort of diminishes, at least for some period of time until people realize that, it sort of diminishes the incentive to, basically the view is we kind of did that. We got the $2.5 to $3.5 trillion, what's the problem? And until people realize it doesn't really work because it's the wrong kind of reductions, you've got this period where the exhaustion sets in and the thought that we already dealt with it is unfortunately there.
Well, one of the major spokespeople for saying that we have had that much savings, it is the White House. And I think the White House has to help shift the narrative, because right now they're saying we've had all the savings, the deficit's come down more than it has in any other time period. And it's actually going to have to be the president who goes out and makes the case to the country why it's so important to do the savings that are the real ones that will stick.
Now, while I'd say the debt fatigue concern is real, and you can see it happen in the press, there's been kind of a three-month break here where nobody's really been talking about it because we focused on other things. And it's one of the things that I do believe sequestration helps with, and the debt ceiling. Because now you have something that's going to get the press interested again. When the press starts talking about it, voters will get more interested again. So there's a real chance that we have kind of a chronic problem that has these acute points where you can focus on it. And we're coming up with one of those. So I'm going to continue to stay optimistic. I think it's one of those things where I've always said it's tough to be a business leader if you don't always think the next door is going to result in a sale, so you go ahead and knock. But at the end of the day, you got to be optimistic. And at each window, sometimes the window is closed with nothing done. Sometimes we've accomplished a bit. But we have to try. And this is a chronic problem that's not going to go away. And we're running into this acute point where we're going to have a chance to do something.
Yeah. I don't want to get too deeply, I'm going to go to your question one second. I don't want to get too deeply into the Washington weeds, but it's interesting that, Bob, you and Maya both were talking about the White House getting involved, and it was just a couple of months ago that I thought people on the Hill were saying they wanted, quote, regular order, which for everybody out here means the normal budget process, House Budget Committee, Senate Budget Committee, yeah. Conference Committee, and then you have something. Yeah. And now we're back to the White. Now we're back to saying it needs to be the White House.
Well, I think there actually can be a combination of that. I mean, we have a budget now that passed the House. We have a budget that passed the Senate. And if you can agree on an outcome, the substance is what matters, right? If you can agree on an outcome, you can actually use regular order through the budget process to make some of these things happen. So I do think you have to have, for lack of a better word, adult supervision from the White House, okay? Every big thing that's ever happened in our country. Well, you've got 535 members, and every big thing that's ever happened in our country has been dealt with through presidential leadership. And let's face it, that really hasn't been the case recently. I think the president is seeing something, is obviously attempting to do it in a very different way. And by the way, that is very, very well received. But we'll know when the president is serious. When you see him standing at a podium, he's the best communicator there is in the world. He's the president of the United States, and he does a good job at the podium. When you see the president of the United States, and I've said this to him, I've said this to Dennis, I've said this to Gene Sperling, I've said, and I think they agree, when the president stands up and says to the American people that the average American is paying for one-third of the cost of Medicare, very difficult to take that public, David, okay? When the president begins doing that, you'll know that the president's serious about trying to put something forth that will solve this problem. So when the public sees that, we'll know we're on our way to hopefully working something out.
The gentleman right there.
Hi, Steve. It's Zachary Carabell. All these questions, obviously, all of you have dealt with, and basically everything about debt has been asked, but so I'll ask something again. One, why the focus on a ratio of debt to GDP when, as we all know, exactly what that ratio should be and how it pertains to future growth is as much a guesstimate about, you know, what weighs and what doesn't as anything else. And so coming up with a ratio we can agree upon is fairly abstract because we don't really know what that ratio ought to be and at what point that it does or does not affect growth. And I guess on Senator Corker's point, given that so much of this is really driven by healthcare and a smaller portion by Social Security, why are we not shifting the discussion away from purely some assessment of a debt ratio to the untenableness of future growth of healthcare spending relative to demographics and to some degree the untenableness of a demographic retirement age of 65 that was never designed to support, you know, 20, 25 years of retirement.
Let me just, I think the panel's addressed some of that, but Peter, let me put the question to you that really follows on Bob's, and I think it answers Zach's as well. Why has the White House not been willing to stand up and say that the American people are only paying a third of the cost of Medicare?
Well, I think, look, there are a couple answers to that, but it's a little awkward for me to be speaking for the White House, so you should ask them. But I think the short answer is that from their perspective, there has not been as serious a proposal on the other side. The conditions were not conducive to actually having that discussion. And it comes back to whether the White House by itself could just go out with a proposal and have it happen, or whether you believe that the world is such that if the White House came out with a proposal, it would be counterproductive because it would just get shot at, and it would also be politically harmful for the White House, which I think is, you know, a not trivial consideration given the polarization that we've experienced. So it's easy for people out of office, like you know, former secretaries of HHS, to come up with serious proposals. It's harder when you're in the seat and you've got this other dynamic of not knowing whether the other side is or is not serious, and I think that's true on both sides.
That's right. Actually, I'm going to help him out. First of all, I very much appreciate what you said, and I agree. That's where our focus needs to be. You know, the average family over their lifetime pays $119,000 into Medicare in today's dollars, including the part the employer pays on their behalf. And the average family takes out $357,000 today. I mean, that just doesn't work. But in fairness, Republicans in the House, I mean, you look at the House budget, nothing on Medicare over the next decade, nothing on Social Security over the next decade. And unfortunately, it's been incorporated into many House members on my side of the aisle's vocabulary that they're telling every senior in the country, they're not going to do anything to you if you're, I shouldn't use that word, nothing's going to change if you're 55 and over. Well, if you score things on a 10-year window, this is a very bright audience or you wouldn't be here, you know, it's hard to get any savings that way. And so Republicans have been, in many ways, I don't like the president's budget, okay? Matter of fact, I don't like any of the budgets that have come out thus far because
except
they really...
Except yours.
Mine was a document to actually change... It wasn't a budget. It was a real document to change the policies. It was much more important than a budget. But back to what I was saying a minute ago, the president, to his credit, has actually, in some ways, put the House Republicans to the left of him on entitlement reforms, because he put in place chain CPI, and that was a rinky-dinky chain CPI, but at least it was a chain CPI. So I agree with Peter, probably, I'm not happy with the administration and the spending and tax. I'm not happy with the administration's fiscal policies at all, okay? But the fact is that I think the environment may be right now, and Republicans haven't exactly been Herculean in their ability to deal with entitlements, in fairness, but hopefully we're at that time where the two can come up with a resolution that makes sense for our country.
Jim Williams, you know.
Sure, we'll repeat it.
My concern is that Washington seems to be fixated more like we can grow out of the problem that we're in and get better than 2% annual growth, lower than 8% unemployment without these entitlement reforms and changes and tax reform. Yet the best way to grow and increase tax revenues is to grow the total economy. And I know Dave and Maya both talked about this, but could you expand on your thoughts that this message just doesn't seem to be as strong as it is? That more could be said from the business community about growing revenues just
well, first of all, I would say that message does get said a lot. And we've tried to always say that one of the things that's going to help drive that growth is to resolve this debt problem. So that message, I'd say, gets sent a lot. There's some disagreement about, not so much in the business community, but others who maintain that we shouldn't be doing anything like this. But in terms of a business community message, that's been pretty consistent. And we say it not just here, but we feel the same way on energy. If we just did a better job in terms of enabling things like more shale gas and tight oil exploration, really took advantage of the what that does for domestic manufacturing, plus the ability to export, being able to do both, there's another $3.5 trillion or so in government revenue through 2035, just by being at the municipal, state, and federal level, being able to do that. So I think that's a message we've definitely been trying to give from all business groups. That includes the Chamber, NAM, BRT.
You want to say that?
Well, so I would say that the reason you care about fiscal responsibility is because it's part of a growth agenda. First, we all wish that there was a magic way that we could just grow the economy externally and we could go up to 4% growth and that would not fix the problems, but it would come darn close. But we don't know how to do that, or we would have been doing that over and over in the past. It does seem that the reason you care about the fiscal issue is, again, not for its own right, but because it's part of a growth strategy. But there are other pieces that have to work. Doing a dumb debt deal is not going to make the situation better. So on the spending side, I think we have to look at the way we spend money. And it is the most short-term consumption-oriented budget you could imagine. And if we were able to, at the same time that we were dealing with these fiscal challenges, think about how to shift our resources into the public investments of infrastructure and human capital and other areas, and that goes back to entitlement reform. That means doing less in consumption areas. That would make a huge difference, just the same as we need to start paying for what we spend, but we need to pay for it through a tax system that's rational and actually creates the right incentives. So I think it's a multiple strategy of not just doing a debt deal, but how you do a debt deal. You can't fix this problem without growth, but you also aren't going to be able to grow your way out of the problem no matter what.
Can I just make a last comment?
I think I'm supposed to go over here, Jim. I'm sorry. Oh, back there? Back there.
Hi, Mark Stegemuller. What are the assumptions in all of those colored lines about the rate of interest that the U.S. government is paying on its debt? Are they realistic? And what happens if they're wrong?
Sounds like a Peter question.
They rise gradually over time, so I think they're not implausible as a sort of central estimate, but what you're highlighting is also we don't know, and to the question earlier, no one knows exactly where a sort of cliff is or a break point is where you actually get into trouble, and I don't think you can actually define a universal law of a debt ratio where that's the case, in part because it depends on investor expectations and investor confidence, and that could depend on lots of other things that you can't put into a model. But for that very reason, I guess my point is, I wouldn't want to take the risk. Like, why even risk it? We can do the right thing in terms of entitlement reform now, and from an insurance perspective, kind of take the risk out of spikes in interest rates, which would make this situation much, not the non-defense discretionary chart, but the overall budget much worse. So I guess I would say two things. Actually, maybe as a sort of soft critique of my friends on the left who are poo-pooing any entitlement changes at all, the sort of view that we shouldn't even be talking about it. I think that has two big problems. One is it is taking the risk that at some point the dynamic gets untenable and it gets away from you, which would be unfortunate. But more importantly, the fact of the matter is there is impetus for deficit, there is a concern, and that itch is going to get scratched somehow. If you're not doing an entitlement reform, you're going to be doing it too much in 2013 and in the wrong way, and that's exactly what's happening. So by not embracing things that are phased in gradually over time, you're not only putting at risk the interest rate trajectory too much, but more importantly for your own objectives of bringing down the unemployment rate really quickly, you're kind of transferring that energy into its most damaging form, which is doing it all today or doing too much today.
And can I just add that we're so lucky to get to do this, as being the safe haven means we have the luxury of time when so many other countries don't. But we're so dependent on borrowing. And if rates go up one percentage point, that's going to add over $1 trillion over 10 years to our interest payment bill. That's about as much as the super committee was unable to find when it was supposed to come up with savings. So for every 1 point increase in interest rates, you'd need a whole nother super committee just to cover the cost. So we're so vulnerable to that uptick.
And for just another point of concern, if you're looking for little factoids, that if we get to the $23 or $24 trillion in 10 years and we end up with, we'll say, a 5% long-term rate, that means we're probably going to be paying about $1 trillion a year in interest annually. Now, we all deal with millions of billions, a trillion just seems like the next number, but to put it into perspective, if you had spent $1 million a day since Jesus Christ was born, about 2012 and a half years ago, you still would not have spent $1 trillion. And that's going to be our annual interest bill if we don't do something. So I worry about what you're talking about.
Bob, do you have any happy words to close out this panel? Because I think we're at the end.
So, look, this is the issue of our time. It's the most important thing as a nation we can possibly deal with. I'm absolutely convinced that if we would come up with the right mix, that we would put this issue in the rearview mirror and our country would see growth that it hasn't seen in some time. I think it is the issue that's creating uncertainty. It's embarrassing to me to be part of a body that I know is hurting the growth in our country and hurting the standard of living of Americans that we all represent. So I hope all of you will stay focused, and I hope that we will come up with a solution. And Steve, while the atmospherics from the standpoint of people caring about this issue is a little bit less, the atmospherics inside Congress is a little bit better, and certainly with the White House. And I'm going to do everything I can between now and September 15th to make it happen.
Okay? Well, thank you for ending on a happy note, and thanks to the panelists for a great job.